Well, right around the country right now, everyone's got their heaters going, and it's one of the first big challenges facing our new Prime Minister, the cost of living spiralling out of control, with a major energy provider this morning warning its own customers to switch before their bills soar.
Let's bring in Deputy Prime Minister Richard Marles on this, who joins us from Canberra. Deputy PM, thanks for your time this morning. It is day one of winter. I think we're all feeling it today. Many families can't afford to turn the heater on, and this is a huge problem, and it's now your problem.
Well, it is a real challenge, and we've got a cost of living crisis in this country. That's what's been left to us by the former government. We've got a real issue with power prices. And again, that's the legacy of having had a decade under the Liberals, where they haven't had a consistent energy policy, where there's been no investment in getting renewable energy going. And that's now the challenge that we face. And we're very well aware of that. It's not something we can solve overnight, but we will be working very hard with the policies that we've put forward to get the energy policy settled, end the climate wars, get renewables into the grid, get power prices down.
Renewables are going to take a long time. I mean, and no one's saying it's not important, but that's going to take some time. Business leaders, including, I know, Innes Willocks this morning saying it'll be apocalyptic rises in energy prices, threatening to cause chaos in the industry and wreak havoc with small businesses, large businesses and households. How do you solve that short term?
Well, I mean, it is a challenge short term, so we're not pretending that there is an immediate answer to this. It's part of a broader question around the cost of living crisis that we've got, and we've spoken a lot about that during the campaign. I mean, there are some things that we can do, you know, sooner rather than later in terms of practical measures around making childcare more affordable, around arguing for a wage increase for those on the minimum wage. There are issues here which are going to take longer, but which we need to start addressing now, as I've said, around having settled policy in relation to energy policy and getting our grid up to a modern standard where it can take on renewables, which are cheaper.
I think that's going to be really hard for people to hear this morning, that there is no solution for now, but it is something you're working on. Look, Labor's new ministry unveiled yesterday too, a record number of women in cabinet. Why would you sideline, though, one of your most experienced people in Tanya Plibersek?
Oh, well, I don't think you can describe the Environment Ministry in those terms. I mean, it's one of the most important ministries that we've got, which has been an enduring passion for Tanya Plibersek, and it's water as well. So in terms of the Murray-Darling Basin and all that needs to be done in water management, in terms of the environment, getting a government which actually has commitment to this, dealing with issues such as the Great Barrier Reef, this is an area where there's a lot of work to be done. It's an enduring passion of Tanya, and it's always been a very senior portfolio in government, and particularly Labor governments.
So did she ask to be moved from education to environment?
Anthony spoke to Tanya, and she was very excited about the opportunity of doing environment and dealing with water. And as I say, these have both been enduring passions of hers.
Really quickly, you're moving into Peter Dutton's office. Did he leave anything for you, like AUKUS agreements?
Thankfully, I'm not actually moving into his physical office. That would be a challenge. Peter has... We've exchanged pleasantries, which have actually been very genuine pleasantries in the last couple of days. He's obviously had a very big week himself. Yeah. But it's a very significant time to be dealing, being the Defence Minister. I'm obviously really excited about the challenge, but I'm really cognizant of the responsibility that comes with it. I think we face the most complex strategic environment that Australia probably has faced since the end of the Second World War.
Well, I'll tell you what, there's a lot going on in the coming days and months. Good luck with it. Nice to talk to you this morning.
See. Nine political editor Chris Yuleman joins us now from Canberra. This is a big push-button issue, this. We knew it was coming, didn't we, Chris? But now it looks like it's going to be, as you just heard then, at least until the end of the year, and no real solutions before that, reasonably.
Carl, it's going to be way longer than that. And we were talking about this through the election campaign for those people who are listening. And what the gentleman before us said was very important. The price of the wholesale price of power in the Australian marketplace on the East Coast is set by the price of gas, or it's set by the price of coal. It's set by the highest cost of generation, not the lowest cost of generation. And this argument that keeps being made and that everyone seems to be prepared to swallow, that more renewable energy on the grid will push the price of energy down, is simply wrong. as long as you need to fill the void when it's not running. When it's not running, it has to be buttressed by something else. That's what set the price. Now, coal is becoming rare. Why? Because there's a war in Ukraine at the moment. We're cutting off coal supplies from Russia, one of the biggest suppliers in the world. Gas is becoming rarer because we've got moratoriums in Australia and because, of course, there's an energy crisis in the rest of the world. That pushes up the price of those commodities. So as long as those prices continue to track up, and no matter how much renewable energy you have on the grid, they will continue to set the price of power because they're essential. Now, this is not a denial of climate change or saying that we shouldn't have renewable energy, but we should be looking at the way the world actually works as opposed to the way that the world, people would like the world to work.
Well, this is the issue too, is that Matt Canavan seemed to be the only person before the election shouting this from the rooftops. Matt Canavan's Matt Canavan, but he was on the show earlier as well saying the exact same thing. Everyone seems to have moved away from that argument.
He wasn't the only one, Carl. In the interviews that I did with Chris Bowen, who is the climate change minister now in this government, I said to him that the price of power would continue to go up, and he was making the argument that he had modelling from Reputex and it was the best modelling you could possibly have, and that because you put more renewable energy on the grid, the price of power would go down. That is not the way the price of power is set in Australia. It's set by the highest cost of generation, not by the lowest cost of generation. And as long as there is a void, no matter what it is, at the moment, right now, on the marketplace in Australia, on the East Coast, 24% of the energy that's running the lights that you're using in your studio now is coming from renewable energy. But 66% is coming from brown or black coal or gas at the moment. And the price, the wholesale price on the East Coast at the moment is around about $400 or more in every state. It should be about $65. It will continue to run at that kind of rate.
So you have industry people this morning saying, and this is a crisis facing the country, it'll be apocalyptic for small to large businesses plus households. We've already heard end of the year. You're saying it's going to go even longer. People need to be aware of it, right? So where is the help going to come for people?
Well, the help would come if we got rid of some of the gas moratoriums in Australia and actually started to put more gas on the marketplace. We need to make a transition, Carl. Like, this is really important, obviously. We have to get the grid greener than it is now. We have to do something about electricity. But that's just the beginning of things, too. Don't forget, industrial production is still heavily reliant on fossil fuels. The thing that people don't seem to be able to come to terms with is that this transition we're making is a wrenching one. Our entire modern society has been built on fossil fuels and a couple of really main ingredients, steel, cement, ammonia, plastics, all of those rely heavily on fossil fuels. So we're beginning to decarbonise the grid, Carl. That's just the beginning. Agricultural production has to be done. Industrial production has to be done. They're the hard parts of this equation, and the future may well be greener, but it will be more expensive.
Labor has a new ministry in order to try and handle all those things. That's a hell of a lot on his plate.
It certainly is, and look, it's not this government's fault that we find ourselves where we are now. Certainly they do deserve some slack in trying to get a handle on this crisis. But I can tell you now, the next cost of living exercise by a government will be something to help people with their electricity prices and their gas prices, because they're the things that are going to really begin to bite. And don't forget, they drive everything else. So as we see the price of electricity and gas march up, it will force up the price of food. It will force up the price of other things, other staples that people need. So this genuinely is a serious problem. And I really wish, when we had people on who were constantly talking about the transition, that they stopped trying to pretend that it is easy. This is a difficult and wrenching transition. Look at what's happening in Europe. You name a country that's got more renewable energy than Australia, Germany, the United Kingdom. The power prices are higher, not lower. There is a reason for what's going on, and people need to be upfront about it.